So good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Thursday CME of South Delhi Pediatric Study Group. The topic for today is interpretation of EEG for pediatricians. And the chairperson is Dr. Sabina Vich. Ma'am is a pediatrician in Max Saket Hospital, and she runs her own clinic also in GK1. I would request Dr. Sabina ma'am to kindly introduce the speaker and chair the session.
Yeah, so we have with us Dr. Pooja. Dr. Pooja Grover Kapoor is a senior consultant pediatric neurologist at Paras Hospital, Gurgaon. And previously, she was attached with Artemis Hospital at Gurgaon. She's done her fellowship in pediatric neurology from Jaslok Hospital, Mumbai, and then fellowship in electrophysiology from Cleveland in USA after her DNB in pediatrics. She has six publications to her name and in national and international journals. She is a reviewer of the Index Journal Indian Pediatrics and has won the scholarship for higher studies from Tata Trust and Bombay Hospital in Mumbai. She is the co-founder and director of Continua Kids, which stands for Center of Neurotherapy in Uniquely Abled Kids. Established in 2016, this therapeutic center has catered to the needs of about 7,000 plus special needs children. Continua Kids has 8 branches in Delhi, NCR, and plans to spread till every special needs kid needs are met with. The mission of Continua is to be a social equalizer and nurture the latent talents of these children with special needs. She's also attached to various NGOs like Khushbu Welfare Society and supporting children of special needs. And her special interest is in developmental disorders like autism and attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, and is dedicatedly working for these children. Now, I don't know why, coincidentally, I was asked to moderate this session for Dr. Pooja, and I would like to start with a case. Like last, about 10 days ago, I saw one kid in my OPD. She is 9 months old, female child, developmentally doing normal. And for the last 1 or 2 days, the parents had noticed that she had started tremulous movements of her face and her shoulders and her head, which lasted momentarily, and it lasted for a couple of seconds. So just to rule out seizures and to take a pediatric neurologist opinion, I asked them to have a video consult with Dr. Pooja. And the same very day, a video consult was done with her. And next day, ma'am asked an EEG person to go to their house, and an EEG was done on the child early morning at around 8:30 or so. And I got a message that the EEG is absolutely normal. So a developmentally normal kid and with an EEG normal and transient attacks. So a diagnosis of shuddering event was made and a shuddering attack. And so we held on for the MRI. We did a basic investigations of blood like calcium and electrolytes, which were all normal. So this saved us from doing further investigations and also putting her on any other drugs. So this is what is the talk for today. Why a pediatrician needs to do an EEG, what a pediatrician needs to know about EEG. And Dr. Pooja is going to give us some tips on that. Over to you, Dr. Pooja.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Sabina. And thank you, South Delhi Group, for giving me this invite. And I'm so happy that I'm talking about this, because as Dr. Sabina said, yes, 10 days back, we had this child and multiple others from different other consultants. And yes, EEG really, really helps us to know what it is happening there and how to proceed. So it is a very good tool if it is handled well. So I'm not going to elaborately tell basically how to read EEG, what basically you have to find out. No, because that is like a part of a pediatric neurologist, and nobody expects a pediatrician to know about it. What I'm going to tell you is like when to order an EEG. Is EEG worth it? And when not to order EEG? Because at times, a few days back, I saw in the group that people were saying that you do like fever profile, and in that sometimes you get Vidal positive plus minus, and then you start treating that, or sometimes you get some UTI plus 5 plus cells. And then you start teaching that UTI, irrespective of whatever the clinical indications are there or not. So same way, EEG could be used in a better way if it is done when we know the indications of doing an EEG. If I do the EEG irrespective of not knowing the indication, it may land up into some mess and the child may have to start or on can be on anti-epileptic. So I think Dr. Rekha Mittal is not there, but at times we have seen like we have stopped more anti-epileptic than we have started with an EEG. So why this all happens, let us have a glimpse of that, okay? So I will try not to make this talk boring. Let's see. So the thing is like EEG, is it that complicated? No, it's not complicated. Yes, reading is a different story, but knowing about EEG is not that complicated. So before we start on, so why and how does these waves of the electrical waves of the EEG happen? So everything happens over here. So we know this is the scalp, then we get the skull, then we have all the three layers of the brain, dura, pia, arachnoid, and then you have these neurons there. So all those neurons who are very much perpendicular to the surface of the scalp, these are the ones which gets you that electrical waves which we see on an EEG. So these are the ones which are the responsible for that. So you have to just see that, you know, even the scalp EEG has got the pitfalls because you have to get this electrical activity from this part to the whole of this insulated part. And then you have to go to this receiver and this receiver puts down certain waves and promotes certain waves. And then you get that EEG. So to know what it is happening, it's like a beautiful thing. There's a lot of science behind that, but I'm not going to discuss that. Just take home messages. So many things happen. The waves have to pass through so much to get this EEG produced. And these are the way how we put up the leads. So there are 21 leads which we put on the head to get those waves. So to make it easier, so once you are reading, you have to find out from which part of the brain the electrical activity is problematic and what part of the brain is causing the seizure. So that's why the frontal part, that means FP1, it is labeled as FP1. These are the frontal part of the brain. This is the temporal part. So over here the temporal lead is put in. Oh, this is the occipital part, and over here we put the occipital lead. And similarly, this is the central part of it. So like frontocentral, centrocentral, and parietocentral. Over here is the parietal part of the brain. So whatever lobes are there below, so we name the electrodes which are placed over it, something like that. And also ever, whichever are the odd electrodes are the left one. And to know whatever is happening on the right side of the brain, you have the even numbers. So if you go to the EEG, this is how an EEG looks like. So if you go, this is what you call as montage. If you see an EEG on every page, you will see these numbers written on. So basically what these numbers signifies are, so the same thing, these numbers only. So we will be able to localize if something is happening in this part. We know, okay, left centroparietal, there is something which is happening. So T6O2, that means right, because all the even numbers are from the right. And we know that temporo-occipital. So this part of the brain. So before we do an MRI, we know that, okay, we have to localize the lesion. We have to look in for something in the right occipital region. So EEG gives you a better glance of where we really have to localize the things. So from here till here is 1 second. So the whole page, I've just cut down the page. This whole page is of 10 seconds. And these dotted lines that from this part to this dotted line, if you could see, this is 1 second. So from this to this is another second. From this to this is another second. So we are covering 1, 2, 3 seconds. And to make it easier, how do we say whether there's alpha or delta or this? So you count the number of waves in this. So we have like in this second, so a 1, a 2, a 3, a 4, the number of humps you get, these are the number of how we quote it. So number of humps, That means 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So that means you have got 9 hertz frequency. That means this is an alpha wave. So this is how we find out alpha, delta, beta, theta and delta. So I'm not going to go into that. Just a rough glimpse of that. This is how you have to look into the EEG. Also make sure that whenever you're looking at the EEG, you don't have to go into the finer detail. Just make a quite a distant and from a distance, try to look at the EEG. You will be able to interpret in a better way. So now all this was theoretical. Now the pitfalls of EEG, why this is in some places you have to do the EEG and why at some places you don't have to do a EEG. The pitfalls are, even though a child may be seizing in front of you, but an EEG may be normal. Why is it so? Because maybe the waves which are coming, the electrical activity which is coming, it has to cross through a lot of the things, the pyometer, durameter, scalp, the skull, and the point when it reaches the scalp, it, the intensity is very low and you may not be able to pick up the discharges, the spike wave. So it may be normal in spite of you having seen the child having a seizure. So again, in an epilepsy or a seizure, clinical history is the best one because the sensitivity of EEG is only 66%. And why? Because the reason which I've told you. Also, if the discharges are somewhere below, deep inside the brain, then also you can get a normal EEG in spite of having a child who's seizing 100 seizures per day. So now, the other thing is that it is abnormal in 1 to 6% of normal children also. So a child who is just moving around and aim for something, maybe some headache, and you ask for an EEG, maybe he may get an abnormal EEG, but that is not an indication to start anti-epileptic. So this slide is the one which is a take-home message that the clinical features have to be most dependent rather than an EEG. EEG will help you to support your clinical features, and at times it is only the clinical features and not the EEG. So this decision is quite tricky, and that is why the role of a pediatric neurologist comes in. But as a pediatrician, I should know these pitfalls. Similarly, we are seeing a lot of autism spectrum. So the literature says that it is abnormal in 5.7 to 59% of the autism spectrum disorder children. So that's quite high. So if you are doing an EEG in a child who has got autism spectrum, make sure that you know that you have a good history of epilepsy and seizure rather than just depending on your EEG. Okay. Now, again, EEG, the other pitfall is it is an technician-dependent investigation. If the EEG is not done in a good way, I may not be able to read the EEG. Nobody can able to read the EEG. So a technician role is very, very, very important. So this is similar to the BERA. So if the BERA has not been done in a good way, a neurologist won't be able to read the finding. And he may say, ki jo hai, sunai nahi deta hai, sensory neural hearing loss hai. Similarly for an EEG, if the EEG is not done in a good way, nobody can report it very well. I'll show you an example. If you look at this EEG, if you look at the upper part, this part of it, this is a normal EEG. Whereas if you look over here, somebody will say, okay, ye to kuch to gadbad hai, this is something, these are the spikes, and this is abnormal looking. But if you see it carefully, these spikes are coming at a very, very regular interval. Basically, these are the heart waves. Maybe that electrode had been put on the scalp over some artery, and because of that, the heartbeat is coming up. So, but if you look at it and just make a moving glance, you may take it as a seizure discharges, a spike discharges. So, you know, this EEG, if the technician would have been smart enough, would have removed the electrode, put it somewhere upper or near, or like make it adjustment so that we don't get this artifact. This is like heartbeat artifact. The artery below this must be pulsating, and this is pulsatile artifact. So these are small things which we should know, because sometimes it looks terrible, and if the report is giving abnormal, you may jump to conclusion, though this is an abnormal EEG, let's start antiepileptic. It is always taught in our PGs and like our super specialization that always, 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 if you have any doubt, underreport the EEG rather than overreport, because if this goes in some person who does not, who just don't know how to read the EEG and just will go by the report, this is an abnormal EEG suggestive of generalized discharges, he may start with an antiepileptic. So underreporting is always, always better rather than overreporting. This is the thing which we used to get when we used to study this. So now the important point is where it has to be done. So the most important thing is to differentiate epileptic from non-epileptic clinical event. So you have to have a good clinical history, and then based on this history, you can always have whether it could be seizure or not, and then you can have a supportive evidence from an EEG. So next is to classify types of epileptic syndrome. So those are very peculiar syndromes which are there only in children, like typical absence epilepsy. That's a syndrome. So I'll give you a brief about also that, because those are only found in children, and those are very typical EEG findings, which I think a pediatrician should know. Then once you have to taper the antiepileptic, the child is on 2 years of antiepileptics and now there are no seizures, and now you want to be sure of that whether you should taper it or not. So once seizure freedom of 2 years is there, you do an EEG, and if you see there are still discharges, you say, okay, another 6 months I'm going to continue. Another 6 months after, we are going to do an EEG and let's see how it does. If that EEG is normal, then only we are going to taper the antiepileptic and stop. So the next is to diagnose non-convulsive status epilepticus. That's a very, very specific entity. Sometimes when the child is in life, is having meningitis and the child is not getting up, you have already given N number of medication, you should suspect ki the child is in deep coma, maybe because the seizures are not visible outside, but he may have non-convulsive but status epilepticus. And the moment you do an EEG, you will see flurry of discharges, and the moment you give midazolam, the child will get up and like will be better. So to differentiate, you have to do an EEG. Similarly, again, now we are seeing a lot and lot of autism in which you are getting a lot of regression. Ek saal mein bachcha theek tha, der saal pe theek tha, and then the child starts losing the social and the communication milestone. That point of time, you have to make sure that do an EEG to rule out whether this is not LKS, that is like Landau-Kleffner syndrome. So I don't want to put up very fancy terms. The thing is like, yes, there are children who were progressing very well in the motor and the social cognition milestone, and by the age of 3 something, they start losing the social communication milestone. Then you have to suspect this to make sure that these are not the electrical activity, because of that the child has lost these milestones. Again, suppose a child who has been diagnosed with meningoencephalitis, if the child has got herpes, there's very specific pattern in the EEG. So sometimes you do this EEG to find out herpes to nahi hai, just to make sure if this is herpes, you can start acyclovir. Now, this again is very important when not to do an EEG. So a case who's got typical febrile seizure. So 18 months above, you know, this is typical febrile seizure, fever aya, seizure aya, less than 15 minutes hua, GTCS tha, the child milestones are all normal, there's no concerns, kabhi family history of febrile seizure bhi hai, you know, this is typical febrile seizure. So there is no fun doing this an EEG, because maybe you may get some discharges or the something or the other, then there's no indication to start an antiepileptic for this. This is the take-home message, because we've seen children who have like typical febrile seizure on history, and the moment they do an EEG, some or the other things comes in, and then it is like they are put on antiepileptic. Similarly for headache, a lot of children who are coming for headache, there's no indication for doing an EEG over here. Same holds true for neurocysticer causes or any space occupying lesion, tuberculoma or tumor, unless and until you have a history of a seizure. Then obviously there are certain phenomena, benign phenomena like gratification phenomena and all, where you don't need the clinical thing, the video of the child along with a good history that the milestones are normal, everything is normal. So that tells you don't need to do any EEG for that. So this is a very dreadful report. So if you look at this EEG report, the history says the child, because of the hyperactivity, the child was referred to do an EEG. And so this is a live example. This child I saw 2-3 days back only. And the history was ki haan hyper hai thoda sa 3 years ka. Somebody did an EEG and the EEG showed abnormal sleep record suggestive of generalized seizure. And the parents came in, ab to dore ki device start karni padegi. No, but when we see the when we saw the EEG, it was normal. So why is it that a lot of time you report a normal EEG as abnormal? The thing is, first of all, you should know the indication. Why are we doing it? If there's no history, please don't do it. The thing is, once it is reported by somebody called as adult neurologist, so if you see the difference, this is adult neurology, very calm EEG, slow waves, everything going on. And this is a normal child EEG, pediatric age group. So you can see the difference. As we grow up, the big waves, the dreadful waves which are there, this calms down and comes to this, comes to peace like this. So once a adult neurologist sees these type of EEG, they say, ye jo hai generalized discharge, this is something looking like a generalized discharge. Whereas a pediatric EEG neurologist knows that this is just a K complex. This happens in a normal sleep pattern. And this is the normal amplitude of the child EEG. So this is normal. So a child who is like, as we grow up, the amplitude decreases, the EEG becomes better and better and more organized. And this is how it looks like. So sometimes it happens, it has been falsely put up, ki jo hai, this could be a generalized epilepsy, whereas this is just a normal phenomena which is there in an EEG in a pediatric age group, especially less than 5 to 7 years of age. So now, once you write for an EEG, suppose you are writing an EEG, make sure that you write for ki ek sleep EEG bhi karana aur awake bhi kara dena. Jab sleep kara lo, uske baad mein bache ko utha dena. Why sleep EEG is very, very important is because it is an activation phenomena. There are certain spikes and wave patterns which are only seen in sleep. So whenever you write an EEG, whenever you order an EEG to be done, write down, please do sleep as well as awake. So awake at times is not important for us, but sleep definitely is important for us. Now, in which part is awake important? Suppose you are suspecting a absence epilepsy, then you have to do a procedure called as hyperventilation procedure during an EEG, because then only the EEG, the typical EEG finding will precipitate. So at this point of time, whenever you are expecting something like this, ask for hyperventilation procedure bhi zarur kariyega EEG mein. Similarly, they do like photic stimulation and trigger that is of not important for a pediatrician. But sleep, definitely. Order for an EEG, write down sleep and awake both. If you are suspecting absence epilepsy, write down ki hyperventilation zarur karayega. And so every time they call ki abhi so nahi raha hai, kya karna hai? So pedicloral is beautifully, it works beautifully well. And now melatonin also. So sometimes we, if pedicloral does not work, then we followed by melatonin gives, melatonin that gives a beautiful sleep, and that could be used very beautifully well there. The only medication is midazolam, which should not be used because sometimes it just causes the EEG flattening and we are not able to see whatever is happening. So most of the time, a pediatrician will ask for ek EEG karana, ek MRI karana hai. So the parents say ki jo MRI ke liye sedation diya tha, uske liye midazolam diya hai, usi ke saath EEG bhi kara lenge. So that's not done because then you are not going to get a clear picture of whatever has happened in the brain. Because then it is like an EEG is done just for the sake of doing EEG. If the child has been given midazolam for doing an MRI brain, make sure that she does the EEG in the next day. Because if under midazolam, you won't be get a good EEG. Okay. Now, let's come to cases. Now, this is the 9-year-old girl who has got poor scholastic performance, daydreaming. Parents are saying ki ye to bas baithe baithe khoti rehti hai, padhai mein niche chali ja rahi hai. And these happen multiple times of day. So jo hai, whenever we say, dekho, utho, to the moment we just shake her and she's back again reading, but then she goes off, dozes off. And similar is the complaint from a teacher. So because of that, her grades are decreasing. And one day, so nobody was caring for her and like she was just being scolded for daydreaming. And then one day she had a GTCS. And that was the point when she came to us because it was a big seizure, GTCS. And this was the procedure which we did. So this is the hyperventilation test. So we just ask the person to blow, and once you blow, you hyperventilate, and that precipitates the absence epilepsy. So if you will see, I'll fast forward the thing. She's hyperventilating. 36 seconds have passed. Now you can see she dozed off. And then now she's again back. Back and responding. So this was the event which was happening. So this was the absence epilepsy which we precipitated by doing an hyperventilation test. So whenever you have this phenomena that the parents are saying ki beech beech mein kho jati hai, do this in your OPD. Ek paper leke usko bolo ki uspe phook marte jao, and then look at this child. So gone. The tone is not gone. She hasn't, she did not fell down, but she became like dazed off. And then again, she's back to normal. And again, she's doing the same stuff. So those were the events. And this was her EEG, a very deadly looking EEG. So this is 3 hertz spike, which we used to do in our PG courses. And it was our MCQ for our post-graduation thing, that in absence epilepsy, what is the type of EEG? This is called as 3 hertz spike. Why 3 hertz spike? So as I already told you that this is 1 second, these interrupted dotted line from this line to this line is 1 second. So in this, if you see at the last line, this last line, if you would be able to see, this is one spike and then followed by a wave, and then you have another spike, then you have a wave, then you have another spike. So these happens is like in 1 second you get 3 spikes. So that is why it's very classically called as 3 hertz spike and wave pattern. And this is very classical for absence epilepsy. And this is how you proceed with an absence epilepsy. So I think this is a pediatrician should work on. So I think this should be diagnosed by a pediatrician, and that's why I included this slide. Now, this is case number 2. A 6-month-old child had birth asphyxia, developmental delays, and at the age of 6 months, the parents noticed ki kuch jerk-like event ho rahe hai. And that too just after awakening or going back to sleep. That means in the drowsy state. Bahut gehri neend mein nahi hai. Only jab wo uth rahe hai ya sone ko ja rahe hote hai, tab aur bahut sare jerk hote hai aur cluster mein aate hai. And now, as the child had birth asphyxia, वैसे ही milestones बहुत पीछे चल रहे थे, and now whatever milestones he had achieved, some smile or that also has gone down, and regression of milestone has occurred. And so this was the video. So if you look at it, so this is one event. That was one chokna. This is coughing. Normal. This is second one. So, you know, very small jerk. So this is how the infantile spasms look like. So those are very, very small, and sometimes they could be easily missed. So that is why a very high level of, suspicion has to be there. You always have to ask, because the parents won't tell. Ki daure aata hai? Nahi, nahi, daura kuch nahi aata. You have to ask, chaukta hai ki nahi, savere jab soke utta hai, ya fir sone ko ja raha hota hai. And you have to do that, this, that's it. That was a seizure, that was a spasm, that was an infantile spasm. The child had coughing, and one more she will have. That's it. So if this is missed, the child life is gone, because you know that causes regression, and then you land up into what you call as West syndrome. And this is the type of EEG. So this is a medical emergency. So we say in our pediatric neurology, this is medical emergency. So why is it so? Because if you will miss this for months together, the child won't get back any milestone. He will like really be in a very bad state of affairs throughout his life. And this EEG is what you call as burst suppression pattern. So you have got a burst, and then there's flattening of EEG, no waves. Brain has nothing power to think even about ki what is ever happening in the world. And by the time the brain gets some power, there's another jerk. So again, there's straight line. So now that happens continuously in the brain, and that gives rise to regression of milestone. And this is a medical emergency. And this has to be dealt with a pediatric neurologist, because we start very, very high doses of steroid and ACTH and other things. So I'm not going to discuss that in this platform right now. So another one. So case 3, 6 years. So again, you have to look in for the age because the last one was 6 months. So that's why it is called as infantile spasm because that happens in that infant period. And now this is again 6 years, grown up girl. So again, early morning gurgling sound, gets up alert, but unable to speak. Now in the previous case, there was like the child, whenever they is in the drowsy state, this used to happen, but the age was 6 months. Now again, you get up just as you go to sleep, you get these events as you go to sleep. So suppose the child starts sleeping at 11 p.m. At 12 p.m., he may get this type of seizures. And suppose the child used to get up at 6 a.m., the child may get the seizures at 5 a.m. So also these are during somewhere around the getting up stage or when just after going to the sleep. Sometimes the seizures happen just 15 minutes into the sleep, but never in the deep sleep. So whatever would be these events would be, they get ye jo hai wo gurgling sound karenge, khub zyada salivation hoga, wo utke baith jayenge, maybe ek haath mein thoda thoda clonic movement ho raha hoga, and they may unable to speak because the type of discharges from where these discharges are coming, those are the area from where these our articulation happens, and that is why we are unable to swallow, and so a lot of salivary secretions happen and the child is unable to sleep. So and this is the type of EG which we get. Why I put this? Because it's a very, very, very common epilepsy, which is called as BEX. So benign epileptiform discharges specifically from the centrotemporal region. And you get a very classical history ki as soon as the child goes to sleep, after he goes to sleep and before his time to get up from the bed, those happens. And the semiology is also the same. Gurgling sea sound, bol nahi payega, chota mota kai baar clonic event ho jata hai, focal. And then you get the discharges from the part of the brain, centrotemporal. So if you look, this is the temporal. I mean, this, if you look at the EEG from a very distance, you would be able to find out, ye kuch toh gadbad ho raha hai yahan pe. Upar wali do lines toh theek hai. This part. Again, this part. These are the spike. You know, spike is kanta. So you can see that these are the spikes which are there. The rest of the brain is normal. Yahan pe bhi kuch spike hai, ye bhi kuch hai, ye kuch alag sa hai, ye kuch alag sa hai, ye bhi spike hai. So once these spikes are there, and then you localize, ye to temporal region se aa rahi hai. In a normal child who has got normal milestone, age is approximately 6 to 8 years, aur jo hai, time bhi bahut fixed hai, semiology bhi bahut fixed hai, then you can say these are BECS. So ye isliye important hai because isme bhi hum bahut zyada treatment karte nahi hai until and unless, because these seizures are very very far apart. Aaj ek aaya ho sakta agle mahine ya 6 mahine ya saal mein hi dusra aaye. So we talk to the parents ki whether we should start anti epileptic or not, and this is one of a very very common epilepsy which the pediatrician can encounter during their practice. So now let's see. So as I told you ki jo hai it is the most important thing is kab ho raha hai, uski semiology kaisi hai, clinical features kaise hain. So this is a child who's like 3 days old, and the 3 day old child after delivery was uneventful, and day 3 of life they had these kinds of movement. So the child is deep sleep.
दौरे हो सकते हैं ये, क्योंकि इन्फेक्शन तो दिमाग का ही लगा था ना इसको, ये तो मैं आपको बताया था कि इन्फेक्शन तो दिमाग का इन्फेक्शन है, अब ये जो हो रहा है ना ये.
So this is very very classical sleep myoclonus. So you know, this child was treated for n number of anti epileptics, thought of ki ye to epilepsy hai, but again normal child, sab kuch uneventful history, nothing happened, day 3 of life presented with this. And if you see, if you'll ask the history, only when the child goes to sleep these happens. And if you see the semiology, these are not jerky movement. If you once more see it, these are not exactly jerky movement, these are more between tremors and jerky movement.
Mera matlab ye hai, main wahi kahunga na, main apne ghar se kyun kahunga, kyunki na dekhiye isko infection to brain.
So these will only un only happen during the sleep. These are benign movement. These goes off like after 3 months of age. And whenever the child is sleeping, these will happen. And once you, if you load this child with Gardenal or Phenobarbital, then the child will sleep more and this will aggravate more. So I had children who like infant of these age group who have been given Gardenal and Aptoin and Midazolam. So once you go to the Midazolam drip, these will happen more because the child will sleep more. So Midazolam precipitate these sleep myoclonus. This is a normal phenomena. If you are in doubt, then again, you can do an EEG and find out. But again, these are very classical. The moment you will get the child awake, it will never happen in awake state. And look at the semiology. Semiology is very different from the clonic seizures or from the tremors. And there's no such history. Family history, normal, OG, antenatal, perinatal, everything is normal. So the child is feeding well, supporty, everything is normal. So again, you want to do an EEG, but if you go to a pediatric neurologist, they'll say, kuch zarurat nahi hai. But yes, pediatrician can do an EEG for this. But this is how we differentiate whether this is a benign phenomena or whether this is a problematic thing. Now again, this. So see, look at the hands. So this is a 9-month-old child who is like pallor present. If you will see at the knuckles, there is darkening at the knuckles, breastfed exclusively, and also the complementary diet was not introduced, put up on cow's milk later on, mixed with water, and this is what you land up into. So I know most of us would be knowing the diagnosis. If you look at the hand movement, these are infantile tremor syndrome. But yes, if you do an EEG, maybe you'll get something and then you can start anti-epileptic. But this child does not require anti-epileptic. This child requires a good nutrition. That's it. So the take-home again message is just read the clinical history, find out the differentials and look for whether you really have to do an EEG. Because EEG is not the only thing which you're going to get your answers from. You have to have a good clinical suspicion, a good know-how when you have to write for an EEG. Okay? So what's the key take-home messages are? Again, a normal EEG does not exclude the diagnosis of epilepsy. And I've told you why. So EEG, yes, helps in differentiating epileptic from non-epileptic clinical event. Also determines the seizure types and the specific epilepsy syndrome. But again, with a pinch of salt. An adult EEG record must include both awake and sleep as far as possible. Agar awake nahi ho raha hai, chote bachcho mein awake, it's impossible. But go for sleep. Even for children like 6 years of age, where you are expecting that it could be Bex, go for a sleep EEG because then only the EEG will tell you the findings. So the EEG which I showed was a sleep EEG. If this EEG would have been done in awake, the finding of Bex would have been mixed completely and you would have got a normal EEG. So there are certain conditions like Bex, which we have discussed, or where you have to have a sleep EEG. Even if the child is good at sleeping, if the child is 6 years old, ki main aram se let jaunga, mummy. No, you have to sedate the child by giving midazolam or melatonin and then do an EEG to get a better yield from the EEG. Again, single routine surface EEG can miss majority of the focal epilepsies. So surface EEG, again, I've already told you, can be normal in children where the epileptic focus is deep inside the brain. And EEG report must always be interpreted in clinical context. So the take-home message is clinical, 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 followed by EEG if you want. Okay, so I think this is I have for today. And let's get it, whether I made some sense out of that, because I did not want to make the presentation very boring. So
thank you Dr. Pooja for waking us up. Though there's a lot more to EEG, and now we can ask some questions. There's yeah. One question in the chat box. Dr. Sankalp had said the first one was ITS. The first one which I was mentioning was not ITS. That was probably a shuddering attack. That child was nutritionally sound, developmentally normal from a good family. So it was diagnosed as a shuddering benign attack, not ITS. Infantile tremor, ma'am ne dikhaya ye. And the second is, how about repeated cases of febrile seizure? Should we be doing EEG in such cases?
No. If you know that this is a typical febrile seizure, so typical febrile seizure to typical febrile seizure rahega. But if you have one event of, even one single event of a febrile seizure along with febrile seizure, then you have to do an EEG. But though, if these are typical, every time you have a fever and a seizure, normal milestones, normal development, nothing more, family history mein kahin kisi ko kabhi seizure aaya tha, febrile, you know this is febrile seizure. And febrile seizure can happen every 6 monthly or like every 15 days. So that is not an indication of doing an EEG. If you are sure of that fever, seizure is precipitated by fever, no. Yes, if you have any afebrile event, the mother says, kal to theek tha, bilkul theek tha, baithe baithe ekdam se seizure aa gaya, then really you have to do an EEG to find out whatever is happening. Or agar kabhi focal aata hai, ek focal aa gaya, that is complex febrile seizure, ya atypical febrile seizure, obviously, then you have to do an MRI also and an EEG also, and you have to do workout. Why this is atypical, it is happening. But if it is like typical, EEG is not going to help you in any ways.
And what should be the timing of that EEG if it is a focal febrile convulsion?
As soon as possible.
We don't need to wait.
So what happens, like ye waiting or non-waiting ka criteria kya hai? So what happens is, like, if I get a seizure right now, my whole of my EEG will go down. My pura ka pura jo waves hai, wo puri ki puri jo hai slow jayengi because I just had an EEG. So the brain wants to just switch off the main supply, and because of that, the slowing of the waves, jo journal meri waves ban rahi hain normally, wo sab slow ho jayengi. To jab slowing hogi, to uske andar spikes dikhte nahi hain. So that is why we used to say after 7 days karayenge, jab waves achhi banne lag jayengi and the child is out of that shock. But right now, what is the purpose? Why are we doing it for febrile seizure? We don't want to do it. But if we are doing it for focal, then I know ki agar focal hai to wahan pe us hisse pe hi slowing aayegi. Do it right now. Why to wait? So you have to know the fundamental, why are we doing it and why are we delaying it. If you want to look in for focal, usi samay kara lijiye. The moment you have a seizure, go for the EEG tomorrow. I don't mind that.
Ma'am, I have one question. Like, a lot of times these children come to the casualty and they are given a loading dose of Eptoin or something. Will it affect the EEG?
So, Eptoin generally does not affect. It is the Gardner or Midazolam which affect. So that again, if you have given that, so we know that the EEG would be like thoda sa gadbad ho sakta hai because aapne Midazolam bahut zyada de diya, fir uske baad thoda EEG would go down. Matlab normal aa jayega ho sakta hai ya slow aa jaye, spikes nahi dikhe basically. So then you can wait. So definitely the anti-epileptics do decrease the epileptogenicity of the EEG. But then if it's an emergency, you can do it always.
And also for stable children, Dr. Pooja, as I mentioned, has started getting the EEG done at home. So she had sent a technician to the child's house, and especially in the lockdown period, so that the parents are not scared to take the children to the hospital. So this facility is also available now to get the EEG done in their house.
So the EEG machine is portable. That's the Neon Coden, the good one. And you can carry that. It's a portable machine. The EEG technician can carry it to the places. So because of Corona, we started this facility, that because nobody was wishing to come to the hospital. So we started sending and doing at home, night EEGs and video EEGs, everything would be done. It's a portable machine, small one, not a big deal.
So any other questions anybody has? I think there are no questions. Thank you, Dr. Pooja. Thank you once again.
One question pertaining to NICUs. Whenever we have got EEGs in the NICUs, because of maybe the effect of other equipments, it is always so what about this Neon Coden machine? Is it how sensitive is it? And
Neon Coden is the best one. Matlab for the EEG, Neon Coden is the best one. Yes, I agree. So you know, EEG is so full of pitfalls. So as Dr. Sankalp said, yes, to do an EEG in a nursery, the ventilator is going on the child, you have so many things, NG feeding is going on, there's a child who's crying next on the next cot. So this all affect the EEG. There are artifacts and artifacts and artifacts. So that is why we ask for a neonatal EEG, at least to do it for 2 to 3 hours, so that maybe in some window period we would be able to read the EEG in a good condition. Because most of the EEG, if the child is on ventilator, if the other person is crying, there is some mobile phone ringing there, some happening noises, you can get just artifacts in the EEG, nothing more. So yes, you have to, for that, what we do is like we prolong the EEG time so that maybe we get some window where we could be able to read a good EEG, some good wave somewhere around. We search for that.
And plus, if the child is moving her head, his head constantly, then also will affect. So which drug is the best one and which will not affect the EEG? Is it pedichloral or melatonin?
Yes. Yeah, so pedichloral and melatonin are good ones. So we used in and out these drugs. So they don't affect the architecture of the EEG, of the waves. So that is why. But midazolam definitely is contraindicated. If you are planning for an EEG, you want to sedate the child, you should not give midazolam at that point of time. No. So, you know, if you will read more, you will find out EEG bahut hi bikar si cheez hai. It's not that great because, you know, the pitfalls. You know, it's very difficult for a person who's reading the EEG. Kaise kya aapne kya likha hai? Because, you know, we really have to find out the good part of the EEG and then we have to make sense out of those waves. And if the EEG is full of artifacts, you doesn't make any sense and then reporting goes off. So then the EEG is a useless entity. So it's a very good EEG done is like very helpful, else it is of no help to anything. It's just wastage of time, money and energy.
So I would just like to add to the case that you showed, infantile spasms wala, where the parents told that bacha chonk jata hai and they will never say ki isko daura aata hai. So we at our hospital, all the babies who have significant asphyxia, moderate to severe encephalopathy, by around 4-5 months of age in their follow-ups, we start showing them these videos that if the child has any of these, please report to us because they get frequently missed and even a week's delay will lead to a lot of development regression.
Yes. So this is there in the IEP now that you have to show these video. You have to specifically ask all your NIC graduates कि जो है कहीं बच्चा चौंकता तो नहीं एंड डू दैट इन फ्रंट ऑफ द पेरेंट्स कि ऐसे तो नहीं होता बस ऐसे तो नहीं होता सो दिस इज लाइक अ रियल टेक होम मैसेज सो वी आर स्पेंडिंग द वर्ड्स एंड समटाइम्स इट्स जस्ट टेकन एज कि जो है वो रिगर्जिटेशन हो रहा है और उसकी वजह से ऐसा हो रहा होगा बट इट इज नॉट सो एंड वी कैन रियली टेक केयर ऑफ आवर चिल्ड्रन इफ वी पिक इट अप ऑन टाइम वी कुड सेव द ब्रेन
And then one of the atypical features in febrile seizures is often the duration of the seizure. Like, do you say that if the duration is more than 15 minutes, one should get EEG and MRI? It qualifies as an atypical febrile seizure.
So the thing is like, if you go it for beyond 15, toh toh status waise hi ho gaya. Toh toh status ki protocol mein chala jayega. Ki status epilepticus. So the child, if the seizures are for any practical reason, if the child is coming seizing to your hospital, it is called a status. So then it would be febrile status. It will be not a typical febrile seizure. So once you go to that algorithm, febrile status, then you will go to the algorithm of status wali, status epilepticus wali algorithm mein chale jayenge aap. Toh phir uska the algorithm is bilkul alag ho jayega na. So tell you the frank thing is that if you go and read the Nelson, the first line is the most commonest cause of status epilepticus in children is typical febrile seizure. So this is so confusing. Yeah. But the moment a child seizes more than 15 minutes, you have to treat as status epilepticus. Typical febrile seizure loses its importance. So that is why somewhere these definitions really help us to define what we are dealing with.
Dr. Pooja, if the infantile spasm is picked up very early, so what is the prognosis like?
If the infantile spasm is picked up very early, the thing is like treat ट्रीट वी विल ट्रीट इट अर्ली. सो जो प्रॉब्लम जो है जो बच्चे के डेवलपमेंटल डिले में पहले से हो रही थी हाइपोक्सिया में, उसमें तो कुछ हेल्प नहीं होगा, बट जो रिग्रेशन जो है वो जो इन्फेंटाइल स्पैजम्स की वजह से हो रहा था वो खत्म हो जाएगा. तो ये चमत्कार नहीं होगा कि बच्चा बिल्कुल भागने लग जाएगा और दौड़ने लग जाएगा और बिल्कुल एब्सोल्युटली नॉर्मल हो जाएगा, बट एटलीस्ट जो है जो बच्चा पहले सोशल स्माइल कर रहा था, 6 महीने का बच्चा सोशल स्माइल और फिक्सेशन आई थी, नेक होल्डिंग अभी नहीं आई थी, वो भी चली गई थी बिकॉज ऑफ इन्फेंटाइल स्पैज्म. सो एटलीस्ट यू वुड बी एबल टू सेव दैट पार्ट ऑफ द थिंग. इट इज नॉट कि जो है आपने वो बचा लिया तो आप पीछे वाला भी ट्रैक अप कर लोगे, वो पिकअप नहीं कर सकते आप बिकॉज देयर इज लॉस इन द ब्रेन. हाइपोक्सिया हुआ है उसको, बट एटलीस्ट द चाइल्ड वो ग्रेड 4 से ग्रेड 5 पे तो नहीं पहुंचेगा.
ओके
मैम, हाउ लॉन्ग इज इनफ? लाइक फॉर एग्जांपल इफ यू हैव अ चाइल्ड विद से मायोक्लोनस, यू वांट टू रूल आउट मायोक्लोनिक सीजर, यू हैव सम इन्फेंटाइल स्पैज्म, यू वांट टू रूल आउट एपिलेप्टिक डिस्चार्जेस, सो कितना कर लें ईजी और व्हिच इज नॉर्मल एंड वी कैन सेफली से कि.
So the thing is, they say 20 minutes of EEG picks up a lot of the features. But what we do is like half an hour se upar hi karte, 40-45 minutes, because sometimes wo thoda bahut artifact hota hai na uske andar. So that part we just exclude. So if you'll ask me, the book says 20 minutes, but that is the ideal 20 minutes. So wo ideal 20 minutes ko aap chahe fir 40 minutes mein kariye, agar beech mein ut gaya to 1 hour bhi kar lijiye. The thing is like you have to have good EEG record of 20 minutes to really make a diagnosis.
And how long of normal EEG rules out an epileptic this thing? So, like for example if you have movement and you feel ki this movement is seizure or not, like myoclonus versus myoclonic seizure, so kitni der ka EEG kar le aur wo normal hai, then we can safely say ki no, the child doesn't have.
तो वो सेफली तो कहीं है नहीं, सेंसिटिविटी तो 66% ही है, खाली सेफली तो कहीं नहीं है. इट वाज योर क्लिनिकल डिसीजन. अब वो पिकअप हो गया तो हो गया. तो व्हाट दे से इज लाइक द फर्स्ट ईजी, अगर आप पहला एक ईजी करते हैं 20 मिनट का या 1 आवर का, तो 66% सेंसिटिविटी है. अगर आप दोबारा करते हैं तो फिर वो 72 हो जाती है. अगर आप तीसरी बार ईजी करते हैं तो वो 76 हो जाती है, बट उसके ऊपर कभी भी नहीं जाती है. The more number of hours you add to the EEG, yes, sensitivity improves, but it's never 100%.
So like any other radiological test, please correlate clinically.
please correlate.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
I think we don't have any more questions, so we can call it a day. Thank you so much, Dr. Pooja. EEG can really be a Pandora's box and you have really simplified it for us. Thank you for telling us when to do it, when, where the EEG will lead us to which part of the brain, and also when not to do it and how to understand all the artifacts. Thank you so much really for taking our time this evening. Thank you, Dr. Sabina, for chairing the session. And thank you all participants for joining in. And please do join in again next Thursday. And we have an interesting session coming up. We'll inform you shortly. Good night, everybody. Good night. Enjoy the lunch.
Yeah. Bye.
Bye, Dr. Pooja. Bye, Sabina.